And for a closer look at all this, we're joined by two people who've written widely on the war, Steve Call, president of the New America Foundation and a staff writer at The New Yorker. His latest book is The Bin Ladens, An Arabian Family in the American Century. And Philip Smucker, an independent journalist and documentary filmmaker. He's author of My Brother, My Enemy, America and the Battle of Ideas Across the Islamic World. Steve Call, as an overview first, are we learning specific new things here, or is it a matter of seeing it in new detail in official documents?
I think it's more a matter of seeing it in new detail in official documents. There are bits and pieces of suggestive new evidence about witness reports of ISI collaboration with the Taliban. You mentioned earlier the possibility of new evidence about civilian deaths in special operations raids, and some eyewitness reports about the use of heat-seeking missiles. Although I have to say, obviously, I haven't read all 70,000 documents, but the excerpts that are available, the testimony in some of these documents is hearsay, wouldn't be courtroom-ready evidence. These are eyewitness reports that often, in the case of aircraft incidents, turn out to be unreliable. And the testimony about ISI is almost all paid informants who claim to be someplace where the writer of the report wasn't also present.
Phil Smucker, what jumps out at you?
Well, the preponderance of evidence that the Pakistani military is turning a blind eye. And there's something of a discussion now between whether The Guardian is right to say there's no smoking gun and the New York Times is leading with this information. Up on the border, it's almost a moot point because you have the Pakistani military located there, and often they are just continuing with their business, not watching the jihadis as they go up into the mountains, cross into Afghanistan to kill Americans.
Just stay there, stay for a moment with you. These are, as we said, kind of low-level reports. Now, does that affect how you read it? I mean, the rawness of some of these or the unvetted nature of some of these reports?
Well, certainly these are—they're not like the Pentagon Papers. This is a broad overview of what's going on, the nitty-gritty at the small American bases, which is kind of astounding, really, because it exposes even what the special forces are doing and the tactics. So it should be a huge embarrassment to the Pentagon.
So, Steve Call, you started by saying some of the caveats that you see in this. What is most significant to you in your reading so far?
Well, I agree with Philip that there is a preponderance of evidence, even though some of it's tainted and dubious, that reminds us of a historical pattern, which U.S. officials have occasionally commented on, but which they often are reluctant to be fully honest about, in my opinion, which is that there is no reason to believe that the Pakistani intelligence service has altered its historical collaboration with the Taliban in pursuit of what it imagines to be its national interests in Afghanistan. At the same time, that government is a major non-NATO ally of the United States in receipt of many hundreds of millions of dollars from U.S. taxpayers. It should be unacceptable for the United States to have an ally actively collaborate with militias that are attacking and killing American soldiers. And if these documents raise that question, force it into the light, then I think that is a constructive contribution.
All right, let's try to walk through some of the other particulars. Phil Smucker, one of them that got a lot of attention is the report that the Taliban used, perhaps used, heat-seeking missiles. What's the significance?
Well, we've seen sophisticated Chinese weapons. These are surface-to-air weapons. They're not Stinger missiles, not to be confused with the Stingers. But one thing we can confirm covering the story over the last 4 years is that a lot of the tactics that have come from Iraq are being transferred by al-Qaeda in Pakistan. It's almost a value added what al-Qaeda is giving to the Taliban in Pakistan. Then they're taking it across the border to attack the Americans.
Steve Call, what would you add to that on the heat-seeking missiles?
Well, I think it's the reports that have been excerpted quote eyewitnesses to the crashing of helicopters apparently struck by missiles. That could well be an indication of the use of Chinese or other missiles. I just take note as a journalist who's covered these things for a long time that the world's most unreliable witnesses are those that claim to see air disasters from the ground because it's just the eye isn't very reliable. But perhaps there's much richer material than that available. I actually think that the granular accounts of corruption by the Afghan government at the local level and the toll of civilian casualties in mistaken raids are probably even more significant than the rest, because they remind us that this war at the local level is experienced often as one in which neither the Afghan government nor the noble intentions of the United States translate into the experience of ordinary Afghans.
What do you make of that, Phil Smucker? I mean, certainly a lot of attention today on the number of what appear to be undocumented strikes against civilians.
Well, I think the bigger problem there is creating a policy that compensates for civilians when they're injured and killed. Because, as General Petraeus has said, certainly this summer is going to be bloodier than last summer. It could be the worst summer we've seen, and the American public has to be prepared for that. But they have to know that the U.S. government cares about the civilians, and there are going to be accidents. And the bigger problem is that we don't see in these reports a policy that really compensates properly for each case across the board.
What about, let me stay with you, what about one other particular, which is the detail on the covert effort by U.S. Special Forces to go after top Taliban leaders? Again, something that there's been a lot of talk about, and I think people sort of know is happening, but here we get more detail.
Right, and I think it's almost unclear. This is a very bird's-eye view of what they're doing. Can it be qualified as targeted assassination? We certainly know that that's going on in Pakistan with the drones. When we get a beat on an al-Qaeda leader, we attack with a drone. I think that the special forces are going on raids, and those raids often become bloody. Now, that's war. That's not targeted assassination.
What do you make of that, Steve Called, more detail on those kinds of operations?
Well, we've known since 9/11 that much of the eastern and southern Afghanistan operations have been turned over to a combination of U.S. Special Forces and CIA paramilitaries, and that their main mission has been to identify, capture, or kill Taliban leaders. So I don't think, in principle, the mission is surprising. I think it's useful to see it in its specificity, to understand its complexity, the nature of the mistakes that are made, the consequences of those mistakes for the broader strategy of persuading Afghans that the international community is still a constructive partner of their efforts to reclaim their country. But the basic idea that we're out there shooting bad guys in eastern Afghanistan doesn't strike me as new.
And Steve Call, just to help our audience here, there's so much more in this, but just help people understand, as someone who's covered the military and intelligence for quite a while, how does something like this even happen, that all of these classified documents become public?
Well, obviously, we don't know, and WikiLeaks isn't saying, and whatever the three news organizations that partnered with them learned about the origin of the documents, if anything, they're not disclosing. I guess we can observe that after 9/11, one of the criticisms of the intelligence community was that there wasn't enough sharing, and that information, even at fairly low levels of classification, tended to be compartmented into boxes. And we saw in the run-up to 9/11 examples of how that got in the way of effective investigations and effective action. And so there was a big push after 9/11 to encourage the intelligence community, through its technology systems and its protocols, to share information and to make it accessible. It would seem that a single individual, I don't know whether that'll be borne out or not, but somebody had access to quite a lot of documents. It is notable that the low level of classification. In the world we live in, 90,000 secret documents sounds like a lot, but we don't actually know the total universe. It could be millions. And in any event, most of the most sensitive operational information in the U.S. system is kept at the top secret or even more secret compartmented information level. And there's, so far as I know, none or not much of that in this batch.
All right. Steve Call and Philip Smucker, thank you both very much.
Thank you.